glorify your name. Hallelujah. Glory. Glory, 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 glory. Woo! Yeah. Amen. Absolutely the most wonderful, the most outstanding time to be alive. Ah! Oh, yeah. Oh, hey, you know what? We got the ball. Yeah. And I'll tell you something else. We on the 1 foot line. Yeah. Uh-huh. It's going to be the final score of the game, too. Yes. I think somebody ought to shout amen again. Glory be to God. Oh, yeah. Oh, but Brother Copeland, look at all the terrible stuff going on. What do you want me to look at that for? Ain't nothing new about that. Oh, yeah, but... yeah, but what? Amen. Come on, get some victory on your mind. Yeah. Hallelujah. You know what? Don't ever do battle with the devil. Do victory with the devil. Amen. We are not victims. We are victors. We are more than conquerors through him that loved us. Glory to God. Amen. Well, Brother Copeland, I just don't understand what all's going on out there. Let me make it easy for you. God is not controlling the world. He controls the church. The church is supposed to be controlling the world. And we getting there. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. There's a whole lot more of the influence of the body of Christ in this earth than most Christians have any idea about. Because most people are so got such tunnel vision, they don't see anything but what's going on in the news media. And if that's all you know, you are grossly misinformed. Because they don't know nothing till after it happens. Amen. Yeah. But there's some of us, a whole bunch of us walking around, praise God. Amen. That know what's going on. We're walking in the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, we're going to have a good time between now and Saturday night. I can tell you that right now. Glory to God. Yes, amen. Father, we give you praise and we honor you, sir. Thank you for this wonderful place to have meetings like this dedicated to your glory. It's such a pleasure, sir. Such an honor to be in a place that belongs to you. And we bless this place. And all those that are involved in it, we bless them. And we thank you for it, sir. We open our hearts. We open our minds. We open our eyes, we open our ears to hear from heaven for revelation. And we give you the praise and the honor and the glory for it in the name above all names, the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Before you're seated, turn around, shake hands with two or three different people. Smile just as big as you can. Tell somebody you love them in the Lord. Yeah, amen. Glory, glory, glory. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Let's receive our evening offering. And amen. Glory to God. Now, you know, some people say, well, wonder why they shout when you receive the offering? Because it's an opportunity to raise your income. Amen. May I come down here where I can talk to you? Amen. Hallelujah. Let's open our Bibles to the 14th chapter of the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 14. And we want to welcome the God Channel tonight. Praise God. They're with us in these meetings, all this entire series of services, all the way through Saturday night. Isn't that a wonderful thing? Praise the Lord. Yeah, I'll tell you what, they are such a blessing to our lives. We've known them since the very beginning, when the God Channel first started, and it's been such a blessing. I'll talk to you some more about it as we go. Matthew chapter 14. Now, to get an insight into this situation in order to properly understand the heart of Jesus here, let's back up to the 10th verse. Or go down to the 10th verse. And he, the king, sent and beheaded John. Of course, you know that's talking about John the Baptist, who was Jesus' first cousin. Now, let me refresh your memory a little bit on how close these two were. When John's mother was carrying John, the angel spoke to Mary and then Mary immediately went to see Elizabeth. When she walked in, well, I say immediately, she was already pregnant, but she walked in there and baby John kicked his mama. Yeah. Yeah, he jumped in the womb. Now, that's close. That's starting right from the beginning, you understand? And remember now, his mission was to go before Jesus. So he was born several months before Jesus. And he preceded Jesus. When Jesus went to the cross, John was already in paradise preparing for Jesus to come. This is a big thing. This is very important. And this is the only man that knew who Jesus really was. He saw the Holy Ghost come on him. He saw it in the Jordan. He baptized him in water. This is close. Now, he sent and beheaded John in the prison. His head was brought in a charger or a large plate and given to the damsel, and she brought it to her mother. His disciples came took up the body, buried it, and went and told Jesus. Now you understand why, when Jesus heard of it, he departed there by ship into a desert place apart. Well, now you can understand why. He didn't go out there to have a healing meeting. He went out there to be by himself with his Father. Amen. But people followed him out there. In one occasion, years ago, back in the early days of this ministry, I inquired of the Lord about that. I questioned him about it. I said, "Sir, what was happening here? Jesus went forth, saw a great multitude, was moved with compassion toward them, and healed their sick. What was going on here?" And the word of the Lord came to me, and he said, "He retaliated." He didn't retaliate in the natural. He didn't go after that king. He went after the devil.
Amen.
Amen. See, flesh and blood is not our enemy. Principalities and powers and rulers of the darkness in this world and wicked spirits in heavenly places. Amen. If you're going to retaliate in the spirit. Because everything that happens in the natural world happens first in the spirit realm. And if the devil can keep you in the natural realm, your weapons being carnal weapons don't work. Our weapons are not carnal. Our weapons are mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. Now, I want you to get the atmosphere of it. Very, very important here. Jesus went forth, saw a great multitude, verse 14, was moved with compassion. Now remember, compassion is not a feeling. Compassion is a person. Yeah, I need to back up just a little bit more. You know, Jesus said, "I only say what I hear my Father say. Amen. I only do what I see my Father do." Amen. And then for instance, in John 5:30, he said, "The Son can do nothing of himself, but what I see my Father do, or what my Father has taught me to do." He didn't say, "I won't do." He said, "I can't."
Amen.
I can't. He ministered as a man. Amen. Now, when you read and study everything that Jesus ever did or said, you have to lay the template of John 14:10. 11 and 12 over that. That is the kingdom of God process for bringing "Thy will be done in heaven on earth." Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thy will be done in heaven be done on the earth. How do you make the transfer? Same process. And that is this. Jesus said, "The words that I speak unto you are not my own. It's the Father that dwelleth within me. He does the works." Then he said, "He that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also." How? Same process. Same process. Quit making up your own words. Just listen for the words. How could we ever do the works of Jesus? Same way Jesus did them. Amen. Because you don't have to do them. It ain't your job to do it. It's your job to say it. It's your job to hear and say. It's his job to do. All right. Now then. He was moved with compassion toward them, and he healed their sick. Well, now we know why. He saw the Father do that. He did it. All right. When it was evening, his disciples came to him saying, "This is a desert place, and the time is now past. Send the multitude away, that they may go into the villages and buy themselves food." Mm-hmm. Now, how much do you think they informed him? Did he already know this is a desert place? Huh? Did he know what time it was? Now, you understand? He heard and saw what the Father said and did, so he was saying and doing that. They came up and told him what they wanted him to do. He's not going to do that. Ain't no way he's going to stop doing what the Father told him to do and do what they said do. Now, before I go any further, when you told him that you got laid off, you didn't inform him anything. When you told him how ugly somebody spoke to you, you didn't inform him anything. Well, no use in telling him that. All you're doing is rehearsing the problem. And if you don't put some faith on it, he didn't hear that. Amen. He's not listening for doubt and unbelief and fear. Amen. Amen. Before you ever go to, well, I'm way ahead of myself. Come on back here. All right. This is a desert place. Now, I want you to notice now, this being a desert place apart, there was no immediate access to food or water. It was getting dark. This is a dangerous place. Now, everything they had said to him is fear-based. All of it's fear-based. There wasn't even, no faith in any, not a word of it. All of it's fear-based. So we have all of the elements for a mini famine. Huh? If it'll work in that environment, it'll work anywhere. It'll work in any kind of famine. What are we talking about here? We're talking about the kingdom of God. Jesus said, if you'll seek first this kingdom, all these things will be added to you. So here we have a man that is functioning under the laws of the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is a form of government. We're not talking about the kingdom of heaven. We're talking about the kingdom of God. Now, once you got born again, Jesus said, it's on the inside of you.
That's right.
Now, listen carefully now. This is a desert place. The time is past. Send the multitude away that they may go into the villages and buy themselves food. Jesus said unto them, they need not depart, you feed them. What? They said, we have here but 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Now listen to this. Hey, you got your catchers out? You have ears to hear? Yes. Say it. I have ears to hear. Bring them here to me. Key to the kingdom. Bring it to me. You bring it to me. All right, stay with me now. He commanded the multitude to sit down on the grass, took the 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Looking up to heaven, he blessed. Now, we're talking about the blessing of the Lord. He blessed, he broke, and gave the loaves to his disciples and the disciples to the multitude. Now, look at that. If you have a Bible that says up there at the top, and Jesus fed the multitude, just write out the side in the parentheses, no, he didn't. Because see, that up there, that ain't scripture. Somebody put that up there. It's right up there. No, he didn't. They did. Jesus supplied it. They fed him.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So the miracle happened. See, the blessing of the Lord, it maketh rich, and he had no sorrow with it. Now, remember the blessing of the Lord. And also, let's go back. I only say what I hear my Father say. One scripture said, I only say what my Father had taught me. See, he learned from the written word. He said to the devil, it is written. He called the wisdom of God the written word of God.
Amen.
Or vice versa, he called the written word the wisdom of God.
Amen.
So, what do you think he prayed?
Father, bless these little fishes and this bread. Bless the baker that baked them and the fisherman that caught them. Bless it to the nourishment of our bodies. Hallelujah, Shama.
Then how come we've been praying that way?
It's true.
We just made it up. It reminds me of what I heard Bill Winston say this. Well, I saw him say it. I was on his television broadcast. And then later he and I both laughed together about it. He said there was some person in his church that she would cut the end off of the roast before she put it in the pan, put it in the oven. Some of you nodding your head, you heard him say it too, you know where I'm going with it. And her husband said, how come you do that? She said, what? He said, how come you cut the end off of the roast before you put it in the pan, put it in the oven? She said, I don't know. Mama always did that. She went over and called. She said, Mama, how come you cut the end off of the roast before you put it in the oven? She said, baby, I don't know. Big Mama always did that. So she called Big Mama. She said, Big Mama, how come you cut the end off of the roast before you put it in the pan, put it in the oven? She said, baby, back that long time ago, the pan was too small. So, I mean, you know, you just do it on that. Oh, how come you do it? Big Mama did it. Mama did it. I'm going to do it too. Didn't make a roast no better. We just did it, you know. That's the way things do. How come we pray what we pray? Because Mama prayed it and because Big Mama prayed it. Right or wrong. As I got into the Word of Faith and got into the Scripture, I started listening to what my daddy prayed. Now, you know, I don't know where you come from, But where I come from, you don't just jump right in there and correct your daddy. No. And so my dad would close every prayer, Lord, forgive us of all of our sins in Jesus' name, amen. Well, I said, what's wrong with that? Well, what'd you do? I asked him what I said. He got to pray. And if the Lord hadn't been after me on this, I wouldn't have done it. But I said, he got through praying, we started to eat, you know. I said, Daddy, could I ask you a question? He said, sure. I said, what'd you do? What are you talking about? I said, what did you do? He said, about what? I said, well, Daddy, you asked God to forgive you your sins. What'd you do? He sat there and looked at me. He'd said it for so many years, he didn't remember saying it. No faith in it. Traditional repetition. I said, and I read 1 John. I said, Daddy, forgive me for I'm not doing this to correct you. I just want to show you something here that the Lord showed me. He said, that's wonderful. I read, you know, 1 John, if we have sinned, I write this to you, little children, that you sin not. If we do sin, we have an advocate with the Father, even the righteous Jesus Christ. Amen. So what's the difference here? Don't be sin-minded.
That's right.
Amen.
Be righteousness of God-minded.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And you don't want to even get into that where it's just something you just repeat over and over and over again. Because without faith, it's impossible to please God. It's just talk. Anyway, now notice this. He blessed and break. So what did God say? Every record we have of God blessing, he said the same thing. Be fruitful, multiply. Well, isn't that what they needed? They needed some serious multiplication here. Amen? They needed about 25, 35, 40, about 50. They needed about 50,000 fish. Amen? So, he said, be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth. That's not talking about population. That's talking about what the earth needs to function. You and I of all generations ought to begin to understand that because we're seeing the earth wear out. We're on the wear out end of this thing. Amen. So and the world's trying to replenish it and they can't. They don't have power. That's the reason that the whole creation is groaning for a manifestation of the sons of God because the blessing is in us. Then it says, subdue the earth, have dominion over it.
Yes.
So we're subduing the earth and its needs. Amen.
Amen.
This mini famine is turning into a feast.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Right out there in the middle of nowhere. He blessed and broke it and gave the loaves to his disciples and the disciples to the multitude. And they did all eat and were filled. They took up of the fragments that remained 12 baskets full. They that had eaten were about 5,000 men besides the women and the children. So there's somewhere around 20,000 people or so. Now, the point of this is this. What whatever we do. We don't just make logical decisions. That's not who we are. Amen. We're going to learn between now and Saturday night that the Scripture says, as He is, so are we in this world.
Amen.
We're supposed to be acting like that, not like the disciples, like Him.
Amen.
We're supposed to be acting like that. He that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. So before we do anything, we inquire of the Lord. Now, as you develop this, turn over to the 8th chapter of Luke. Luke chapter 8. Here Jesus is preaching the sower went out to sow seed. Now, most people don't recognize and understand that Jesus was and still is a preacher. Amen. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for He's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, to preach deliverance to the captive, to preach recovery of sight to the blind, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Amen. So now He's preaching. I want you to notice then in verse 8, other fell on good ground and sprang up and bare fruit 100-fold. When He had said these things, He cried. He got loud. That's where all us preachers get this. That's where we get it. He cried, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear.
Amen.
Why? If you hear it, you can say it. If you say it, God will do it. I don't preach me happy. Woo! Glory to God. Yes. Amen. That's the reason He kept saying, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. He that hath ears to hear, more will be given. He that hath not ears to hear, what he has be taken away from him. Not by God, but the devil. He's talking about the devil stealing the word. The sower sows the word. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. Because the words that he hears are not his own. He's talking about you and me. And so the devil jumps in there. He knows he gotta get that out of you some way, because if it stays in there long enough, you say it, he's had it. So what's he got to do? He got to get you to look at him instead of looking at God. Because if you'll look at him and say what he says, then he can do the work. Same process, different words. Can't change the process. You can only change the words. Hallelujah. Well, let's say I preach part of tomorrow night, I preach part of Saturday night. It'll bear repeating, won't it? Praise God. Oh, like I told you, we're going to have us a good time in this place. Yeah, I'll tell you what, there's so much anointing up here on this place tonight. If you can't preach here, you can't preach, buddy. Amen. You need to go back to your day job. Now, whether it's, don't just wait until it's offering time or wait until somebody's sick. No, practice all day long, every day.
Amen.
You're listening all the time. You listen to it. Don't start out on something like cancer. No, man, hey, start on the little stuff. You know what I started listening to God on? My socks. Because I didn't have any. And I didn't have no money. Well, I had some, but I almost didn't have any. And I needed some socks. And I I was asking God for money enough to go buy three or four pairs of socks. And what? Oh, okay. You use your faith. Go to the Word. Find where it promises you. Put that Word in your mouth, in your eyes, in your ears, in your heart. That's the way you buy without money. Like in Isaiah 55. Did you know kings buy without money? So do presidents and governors. What do? They say, oh, yeah, get that for me, will you? I need that. The pair of blue ones, that look good. Yeah, pick those up for me. See? Well, we are kings and priests. And so I just started doing that, started listening to him. Over a pair of socks. Got them, too. Amen. Amen. And then I began to inquire of the Lord about what I was supposed to wear today. Then I inquired of the Lord about what I'm supposed to wear during the service. And after a while, I had two or three suits. I started out with one seriously altered suit. You've heard me talk about that suit. I used to weigh 100 pounds more than I do now. And when the Lord first started taking that fat off me, I got down, you know, below 200 pounds and I'm coming down. And I only had one suit and I kept taking it back to get it altered. And the last time I took it over there, the man had done all the alterations on that. He said, Mr. Kenner, I don't think I'm going to be able to take that suit up anymore. I said, why? He said, I think I'm paying them one more time. Man, you're going to have one big pocket right in the back. And he did, and I did. My pockets came together in the back. Oh, I tell you. But you bring it to him. And I can tell you some wonderful stories about that. But the thing of it is, see, I'm learning how. Yeah, but Brother Copeland, he's going to send me out there looking funny. No, you've been looking funny. You need a little change of your color guide ain't all that hot. Your wife been trying to tell you that, man. Now, see, this is where faith in God comes. I don't care if I miss it and walk out there really looking funny. What I care?
Come on.
Amen.
Amen.
When you care, it's because of your pride. Dump that nasty pride. God's not going to let you be shamed. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. No, 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 no. You just have some more. Believe the love. We have known and believed the love that he has to us. He loves you. He loves you. It's important. There may be somebody there in that place where you're going. It may be somebody on the job today that just for some reason or other, light blue is their most favorite color. And you walk in there and God anoints that blue shirt you got on. And they see that. And all of a sudden, favor for you comes on them.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Now you got a witness coming. Mm-hmm. See, God plans everything to win souls. That's his business. He's not in the business of making money. He got money.
Yes.
You ain't in the business of making money either. You got money and didn't know it.
Amen.
I hadn't forgotten receiving the offering. But ain't no good to receive the offering if you don't hear from God.
That's
You just pull something out of your purse and plunk it in there. That's blessable, but it's not all that fruitful. Aha. But when you inquire of the Lord, Lord, what I need to be doing in this offering tonight? Amen. I'm going to put something in there. Don't ever let an offering get by. Yeah, Brother Copeland, I don't have much. That's the reason.
It's truth.
You still love me?
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. When you realize who you are in Christ Jesus, bring it to Him. I don't care if it's nothing but a button off your shirt. I've done that. I know a little offering get by, and I didn't have anything, man. And I told the Lord more than once, I said, what? My shoes? What is it? Had God to supernaturally provide for me to put things in an offering.
Amen.
When I didn't have anything.
That's right.
Amen. He gave me seed to sow.
Yeah.
He not provides, He ministers seed to the sower.
Amen.
Amen. Why? Because He's interested in being fruitful and multiply and replenish. Because that's who we are. We are the replenishers. Glory to God. Amen. Father, we thank You tonight. We open our ears to You, sir. We bring it to You, Lord Jesus. And we thank You for it. We pray over it. Be fruitful. Multiply. Replenish the earth. Subdue it and have dominion over it, thus saith the Lord. I am the Lord of the harvest. I always do my part. But when you don't give me anything to work with, I cannot move in on you without an invitation. I am the Lord of the harvest, saith the Lord. You are the sower of the seed. And together we'll work. And together we will see harvests like never, ever before in the history of this planet since the Garden of Eden. For Eden time has come. Garden of Eden days are here again.
Amen.
It is my time, saith the Lord. And I rejoice. You rejoice with me, and together we will see heaven come down. Hallelujah. Woo, glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I see my internet. Yeah, thank you, Lord. We have not been as expectant of the supernatural as we should have been. We need to step up where that's concerned. We've been too lax in those areas. Amen. It's time. God's have always been ready. But it's time for supernatural harvest.
Amen.
Gloria and I have experienced it in times past. You know, one of the most dangerous things is to get all your bills paid and just begin to, quote, live within your means. Yeah, that's all right if you know what that means.
That's right.
We are not bound to the natural world of means. See, the economy is not our means. No, no. Your job is not your means. Your job is none but your seed bin. I don't care. See, the job you're on, you're supposed to be on the job that God called you to be on, not go find you a job and then ask Him to bless it. Because the scripture said, every member of the body of Christ, He has set in a place that pleases Him. Well, the place that pleases Him, the only thing that pleases Him is the prosperity of His servants and His family. Amen. Well, you know, I mean, after all, you can be whatever you want to be. Not if you're a Christian. No, no. We are what we are called to be. Because that's where the grace is. And God may have called you to flip burgers someplace. That don't mean you got to live on minimum wage.
Right. Come on.
You can take minimum wage and bless somebody with that.
Come on. Yes. Amen.
No, you're there because you're called to be there.
Yes.
Huh? And when you're there because you're called to be there, that's where all the grace is. Amen. You know, you may only be there because of one person that's going to be coming in that place. You may be that the answer to that person. God's had you working there for a year for that one person that's coming in there. This ain't all about you.
That's right.
It ain't all about me. It's about the kingdom.
Amen. Amen.
Why do you get up and why do you go to work? Well, baby got to have some new clothes and, you know, and blah, blah, blah. If that's your motive for working, you ain't no different than the Gentiles. Our motive for going wherever we go is the kingdom.
Amen.
Promote the kingdom of God. We are citizens of heaven. We've been raised up and made to sit together with Him in heavenly places. Praise God. We've been translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God's dear Son. Amen. I am where I am because God told me to be there. When I finally got that right, man, I was 30 years old before I ever got in the will of God. My first day in the perfect will of God was the biggest day in my life. I couldn't sleep. I was so excited. Amen.
Amen.
Well, yeah, but Brother Coleman, what am I going to do? You mean I've talked all this time and you don't know what you're going to do? God's not going to just yank you up in the morning and say, go in there and quit that job. And no, that's the devil to tell you some kind of line of bull like that. Forgive me, but I ain't got long. I need to be plain here. Amen. Yeah. No, that's the devil to tear into you like that. You say, Lord, I'm yours to command, and I'm inquiring of you about your plan, your purpose, your pursuits, your will be done on earth in my life as it is in heaven. Now,
yes.
What's my first step, sir?
Amen.
Amen. It only takes one more step, and one more step, and one more step. He got you on your way. Well, I just can't figure. I know you can't, so shut up. Quit trying to figure it. Amen. Quit moaning around about it. Put a smile on your face. Say, glory to God. You know what? I am in the perfect will of God today.
Amen.
Oh, yeah, you are, because you committed to it. Now, it's His job. To work you right back onto that divine course. And for once in your life, you be on the freeway. Instead of going through Sickville. Amen. You know, and broke, can't get along street. That's the reason many Christians have so much trouble all the time. Because the grace of God is over here, and they're over here. Your victory is over there. Your fun is over there. Your joy is over there. And you over here. Ain't no wonder the devil gets away with what he gets away with. But all you got to do is just repent. Say, Father, forgive me. Don't go start feeling bad about it. I mean, condemnation won't change anything. Amen. Never has changed anything. All that does is just make you mad at yourself. So just repent and say, thank you, sir. I believe I received my forgiveness and my cleansing from all unrighteousness. Amen. 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 If he cleanses you from all unrighteousness, what do you got left? Righteousness.
Amen.
Amen. That just simply means right.
Amen.
I'm right about it. Glory to God. And he can start just maneuvering things, you know, and he working things around. And the next thing you know, you think, how then? Look at this. Whew, glory to God. Life is so good. And you're still in the same mud hole you was in before. But the mud smells better than it did. Because you're on your way out, man. I mean, this mud getting sweeter every day. This is life in the faith lane. Faith in God. Faith in God. Same old ugly two before job that you had before. Amen. But now, the thing looks different. People look different. Why? The love of God's working in you. And when the love's working in you, faith works by love. And things start looking good instead of bad. Instead of you trying to figure something out, you're just listening. Ain't my job to do it. My job to believe it and say it. It's Father within me. He does the work. Amen. Y'all have a nice day. Amen. Father, we thank you. And we give you praise, sir, in the name. Oh, yes, sir. In the name of Jesus. Amen.